What's going on, everyone? We're back again with something slightly different today. These are the Luckfox Pico and Pico Pluses. See, the Pico is the one that has no Ethernet interface or SPI flash. The Pico Plus does, although this still has the pins if you want to add the Ethernet interface later. And I don't understand why the internet isn't going mad about these, because I am. I'm going to order a pile more of them. If you want some in stock, let me know too. Link to my shop below. I don't have any in stock, but I imagine people will want these. So we'll get onto why in a moment. First of all, though, I just want to say thanks again to PCBWay. I don't know why, but they keep sponsoring me. So I will show off some of their stuff. I just got these boards arrived the other day. I'm making these little LED modules. As you can see, these are based around the WS2112Bs. And I designed this PCB, which is meant to take pretty much any SoC that I use, or MCU, depending on what terminology you use. I can't remember what's right. SoC, MCU, yeah, much the same. And you can also just use USB or the standard pins on this. And I got them to make it, and it came back really, really nice. I was quite impressed with that. I also got them to assemble some, because if you didn't know, they do assembly. And they supply the parts as well at a really good price. So I got this supplied, assembled, and fully functioning, including most of the back, but without these, for stuff all, because they do some great deals. Like, you get PCB prototyping for $5. There's a link in the description just below, actually. $5 off your first order. They also do these deals like $30 for a prototype assembly batch, which is roughly what I used for this, or what I was looking at using. And they do excellent work. As you can see, like the soldering, the edges of the boards, everything's fantastic. And if you get stuck, they do have a really good team that communicate well. Like, they told me when some of the boards had these holes filled in, I was fine with that. They do technical designs, 3D printing, CNC milling, flexible, rigid, everything in between. Like, whatever your PCB needs are, they can do it. So definitely reach out to them if you need anything. Thanks again to them for sponsoring this. Let's keep having a look at this really interesting, strange little thing I found. Now, this one, the Plus version, was about $15 Australian. The non-Plus version was about $10 Australian. So quite affordable in my mind. But I'm trying to figure out if I'm missing something. Like, why are these cheap? And why have I not heard of them before? They've been around for a while too. So let's go have a look at the specs of them. Over on the computer, it starts to get pretty interesting. We've got a Rockchip RV-103. It's got all your standard sort of things that you'll see on a Milk V-Dura, an Ox64, anything that's like that half credit card size. The USB-C interface is great, and having the camera connector is great as well. This is interesting though. It's got an ARM Cortex A7, but then it's got a RISC-V MCU, and I don't fully understand what they're calling an MCU here. I found some block diagrams, I found some data sheets. It's really hard to figure out. I think the RISC-V core, which I can't even find any details on, is doing like possibly the AI or the multimedia processing, like the camera processing. It says 512 meg RAM here. I haven't seen one with that. These have 64 meg of DDR2, two-lane camera interface, third generation ISP, and the 0.5 trillion operations or tera operations NPU, which is pretty neat. I've also seen somewhere that it said the intake mode will do higher than that. But again, not too sure, because everything's a little bit lackluster as far as the documentation and, you know, the general understanding goes. USB-T host and device is pretty sweet. Standard GPIO, Ethernet, which we talked about, and the option for an SD card module on both, with the Pico Plus having the SPI pre-soldered. You can just solder your own on too. So that is a, over here we go, that is a 1 gigabit WinBond chip, so 128 meg. But you could just solder your own on, and I've got a couple of them I might slap on, because it gives you a few more options, and we'll get onto that too. If we go and have a look at the comparison, you can see there's a few variations here in the higher ones. The Pico Pros and Pico Max move up to an RV-106. Still no 512 megs, so I'm not sure where that came from. And these have extra pins. I'm not sure really what the extra pin is or how that works, or if they haven't remapped it. But yeah, interesting design. I think it's really cool. So let's get on, pardon my burp if I didn't cut that, and actually have a look at how they use. And the Ethernet module, by the way, is pretty much the same as what you'd get for the Milk 5 or Milk Feed Geo as well. So you can just attach that or even solder some cables straight onto it, but you might blow it up like I do sometimes. So be careful with that. Now, if you do want to see more of this stuff, by the way, don't forget to like and subscribe. It really helps me out. It gives me an idea of what you want to see. So hit that now, hit the bell if you want the notifications, add some comments, all that fluff that YouTube wants me to tell you. What we're going to do first is just go for the USB, for the SD card option, because that's kind of the simpler approach, depending on who you ask. And for that, because we don't have a network interface or anything, I've just soldered on three pins to your TX, RX, and ground on here. We'll get back to that in a moment though. First up, grab your SD card, and let's grab an SD card reader and go over to the computer. For this, you're going to need the SoC toolkit, which I'll put a link to below, and you'll also need the images for each of these, which I'll put links to because they were really hard to get at one point. I think I had to use Baidu Cloud or something. For this SD card, I'll also just put a raw SD card image so you don't have to go through this whole thing. But once it's launched, pick your chip, hit SD tool, hit SD boot, and that's when you want to put your SD card reader in, because I have had some issues with this thing just not picking up the SD card unless you do it this way. There we go, it's picked it up. Now, if we go boot files and we go to the Pico image, you want to grab everything except for that update file. I don't even know why that was in there, but that's fine. And then simply hit create SD. So that step to start with is really easy. Simpler than most other things that I've used and works straight out the box. So that's the SD card made. As I said, I'll put a link to that below, but let's pull it back out now. And I'm going to use the old and trusty CP2104 to connect to this. So TX, RX, ground, I'm using black as the ground, so I'm just going to, if I can get everything right, put them in reverse. And then I'll put my SD card in. Note that the SD or TF card slot is actually raised slightly, which is really good. So it's not SPI flash or SD card. You can have both. This does fit, the SD card does fit in the Plus Model 2. Now that's connected, I'm going to bring this back up and actually zoom in again. And we'll see when we connect it, there is this little LED of what's going on. First of all, though, quickly jump to the computer. Why do I not have PuTTy going? You want to go serial COM4 in my case, but check yours first in device manager, 1152.100. And then you want to turn off your flow control for this one. So none. Connect to that. Now, plug in this USB port and we can watch this LED as it does stuff whilst we also watch it boot. Damn, off to the races that quickly, loading the kernel already. And you can see the little LEDs giving you a good indication that's working pretty hard. And now it's booted, that LED is just going to that kind of heartbeat, so we know she's stable, which is excellent. If we go over now and have a look at this, ignore what I'm talking about with USB 0 and the IP address there. Let's just quickly have a look at free-m. Now, we're not seeing 64 meg, that's fine. The reason is, from what I can find, it reserves about half the RAM for the multimedia processing. That's probably allocated to the RISC-V core. Now, if we go DF-H, we can see it's only using about 14 meg of storage space. And we've got some odd partitions there we'll have a look at in a tick. Now, lastly, cat proc CPU info, whoop, if I can type, is just showing that one ARM core. So that's pretty much all well and good. You do have some other little oddities, though. If you notice, it's dropped straight to busy box. It's in single user mode. What else have I missed? It's a 5.10 kernel here. As you'd expect, it's a very stable long-term kernel. But then we've got some interesting things. If we have a look at this Rockchip test folder, we've got this Rockchip test shell script. So if we go sh Rockchip test, Rockchip test, we basically have some burning tools there, which is pretty sweet. We do also have this OEM folder, which I thought was really strange. And then I went digging and I found in user bin, you've got all of these awesome tests and examples. So this is going to test pretty much anything that you might want to do with this baby. It's got your simple AI testing in there, your vision testing, your image processing, video processing, camera interface, I2C, SPI, GPIOs, PWM, everything like that, all available, ready to go. So it took me probably what, less than 2 minutes to flash the SD card, boot, plug it in, boot it up and connect with PuTTy. And I'm already in an environment that's fully usable. I think that is awesome. What does bother me, if you didn't notice before back on the computer, is it's actually using 19 or 20 meg of RAM. That confuses me a bit because the Ox64 only uses 9. So that's, it's a bit heavy. There's some optimization that can probably all do there, but there is a few reasons for it too. And if LS mods installed, it's going to have a lot to do with some of those drivers, which we'll have a look shortly too. So I'll put a link to this SD card image along with the bits of software below that you need. But now let's have a look at the other option, which is just using the SPI flash. So if you're only booting from the SPI flash here and you're not using the SD card slot, that leaves you some options for the SD card slot, like using it for bulk storage if you are, say, connecting a camera and taking pictures. So what we want to do this time, instead of just plugging this in and letting it boot normal, you see that LED starts going crazy. You want to hold that boot button. That puts into the MaskROM mode, then plug it in and let go. No crazy LED. Now you will need to install the drivers to do this. Let's get rid of PuTTY because I don't need that anymore. You'll see here, there is the driver assistant. So I'll put a link to that below as well. And what you do then is if we go back into our SoC toolkit and we launch this, pick your chip, and you see you've got the MaskROM device there. Now, this time to flash the SPI, what you want to do is go search path, go to the image for the Pico Plus, select folder, and it says, do you want to load the environment? You go yes, and you can see it's got all the different images laid out in the memory map. Tick all of them, make sure that reset is ticked if you want it to boot straight up afterwards, and then just hit download. And that's going to send everything straight across. Now, it's good to note here that I have had some issues doing this with PuTTY still open. I'm not sure why, but it kept failing at this point where it was here, writing LBA from file. So from what I understand, it assembles all the images into a file, then just writes the file using that download bin first. That kept failing. It really had me stumped until I closed PuTTY. I don't know why. So if you have the same issue, try that. That's all booted. That's all wiped, and you can see it's booted now. It's doing its thing. What I just want to show you, though, is if you do have to actually boot from the SD card again, you do need to erase the SPI. The chip, which has the bootloader and the RAM and everything all built into this, will try to boot from SPI first. If it can't, then it'll boot from SD card. So to do this, you still need to tick just download bin, because that's like the control firmware that sits on there. You then hit download bin there to push that across. Once it's pushed, then you can do erase all. As it is now, though, this is up and running again. We don't have any debug header soldered on, though, so we're going to connect to it slightly differently, and that's using the RNDIS interface. If we have a look here, we can see we've got an unidentified network, and you just need to set a static IP on this. So I've set 172.32.0.100. The IP address, as you saw before, is in that range. So set that, and then if you, as long as you've got ADB installed, and I'll put a link below as well, you can connect to that static IP of .93, and then you can just launch the shell. And that's it. We're already connected to it. I find that a lot easier. I mean, I found flashing, making the SD card easy. I found flashing the SPI easy. I found connecting to it through GPIO easy. It didn't require like 2 million bits per second or anything. And I found connecting to it using the RNDIS really easy, which is just kind of insane in my understanding of things. This is the easiest one I've used so far. It's got an NPU built in. It's got ARM Cortex and RISC-V. It's got Ethernet. And you can see that here. If we go ifconfig, there's your Ethernet interface. It's got USB host and device mode. It's got example code. It supports booting from multiple sources. It just works. So I'm really impressed. I'd love to know what you think. I'm not going to measure the power consumption yet because I don't have my little meter here. But I'd love, you know, why isn't it more prevalent in the market? And how is the RISC-V processor used? Any information you have or any questions you have, slap them below in the comments because I'm super curious. I think I'm going to order some more of these and start using these. I think they're designed for image processing. Kind of all fits together. Network interface, camera interface, boot from SPI, store the images on the SD card, process them with the NPU. So makes sense to me. But let me know what you think. What am I missing? What other great options are there for working with these things? These are, in my mind, the easiest and the simplest I've used. So what's in your mind? Sorry, I'm getting tired. We've got a storm coming too, so I'm going to go weather that. Thanks again to PCBWay for continuing to support this channel and sponsor this video specifically. As I said, like and subscribe if you want to see more. It really does help and I really do appreciate it. Otherwise, just leave comments. So until then, take it easy, have fun. Catch you next time.